to tell you about some work that I've been doing with Hong Lu and Antonio Garcia Garcia. Hopefully the paper will come out in the next few days, maybe in the next week. Let me begin by reviewing what exactly the Kibble Zurek mechanism is. Consider some quantum field theory with a second order phase transition. I'm going to, just for the sake of example, focus on superfluids today, but essentially everything I'm going to say is going to be general. You have a symmetry group for a superfluid, which is U1, and for sufficiently low temperatures, that U1 is spontaneously broken. There's an ordered parameter, which is non-zero in the broken phase. The question that Kibble Zurek, mechanism addresses, is what happens when the temperature is dynamically lowered through the critical temperature. So you can define the reduced temperature epsilon and T as follows. And so the question is, what happens if you start off in the unbroken phase and dynamically change the temperature into the broken phase? So you can imagine having a box of superfluid. Roughly speaking, what's going to happen is that when you lower the temperature, there are going to be some domains that form with some characteristic length scale that I'll just call C for a moment. And in each of these domains, the phase of the order parameter will be different. And on the interfaces of these domains, you can have topological defects. Within the context of superfluids, these defects are just simply called dependencies. And so what you expect is that the density of defects scales up the correlation length to the minus dimension of space. So what? How does this work? The theory that has a second order phase transition, the correlation length, the equilibrium correlation length, diverges as epsilon goes to zero, and the equilibrium relaxation time diverges as the reduced temperature goes to zero. These positive exponents and z times q, where z is the exponent. What happens is that when you lower the temperature through the critical point, it's inevitable that the system becomes far from equilibrium eventually. And the reason is simply that the equilibrium relaxation time diverges at the critical point. Okay, so the system cannot respond adiabatically. However, there must be a point in time that I call the freeze-out time here, where the system becomes far from equilibrium. And at that time, the characteristic length scale is just the correlation length evaluated at the freeze-out time. Remember, it's a function of time here. And so, what's typically assumed, what happens is that in between plus minus T freeze, the dynamics of the system are frozen. You can think about this as being, roughly speaking, anyway, a consequence of a divergent relaxation time. And after this time plus T freeze, it's generally assumed that the condensate will grow adiabatically. So the equilibrium, the condensate is related to the reduced temperature by some critical exponent beta. So the general assumption is the condensate will grow like epsilon T to the point beta after this freezing. And so if you consider a linear point on this parametrically slow, you can easily work out just resistance field lines of algebra that this freeze out time scales like the quench time point Q to these powers. It's just related to the equilibrium exponents. And that the freeze out time also has this scaling right here. And then you can estimate the density of topological defects in the form when the condensate just starts to deform. And it has this scaling. This is the standard. Now, let me tell you some motivational claims here for the rest of the talk. My first motivational claim is that the dynamics after plus T freeze need not be adiabatic. In particular, I will argue and I will demonstrate that there exists another time scale called the equilibrium time scale, such that for all times between T, Q, and T freeze, the system is not responding adiabatically. There will be no condensate that forms until this equilibration. In particular, in the models I'm going to consider today, we will see that it's not the dynamics before the freeze-out time that determines the correlation, but rather
dynamics after you pass the peaks. And what we're going to find is that the correlation length at this equilibration time, when you have a wireless leaving point and safety point, will be much greater than the phase out scale. So, I should note that in a recent review by Zurek notes that if you just use this freeze-out scale right here, it's an estimate that just the amount of defects, you often have to insert a fudge factor that's about 5 to 10 or so, depending on the model. And so we're gonna naturally explain this phenomenon right here. If I were going to do it, you can guess we're going to use. Say too, the first ones to do this. There was a nice paper just about a couple weeks ago by Julian Sommer and Zurek Salas, who studied the Kibble Zurek mechanism in a 1+1 image. It's the first tour de force exploration via holography. So, I'm not really going to tell you much about how we do the calculation. I'm going to tell you what model we're going to consider. The model that we're going to consider was one known by Gary and Pompeo, a study by Gary and Pompeo a long time ago. It consists of gravity coupled to a gauge field and a benchmark scalar field. And we're going to solve this model numerically. We're going to also go through the mechanism in detail where the charge goes to infinity. The important points that you need to know here is that the asymptotics of the scalar field near the boundary in the center space encodes the expectation value of the quantum theory we are talking about. The other important points that you need to know is that there exists black brain solutions to the equations of motion here, where if the black brain is sufficiently hot, the scalar field vanishes. If the black brain is sufficiently cold, the scalar field turns off. Symmetry working, that corresponds to the superfluid phase transition. So, the game plan that we're going to do today is we're going to start off in the equilibrium state at a temperature above TC. There's our system right here above TC. We're going to put our gravitational system, I'm going to be very schematic here, in contact with the thermal reservoir, which is cool. We're going to cool the black brain down. We're going to cool it down through TC. We're going to watch the bulk scalar field form and correspondingly the boundary field form. Okay. And unfortunately, I'm not going to be able to tell you anything about the numerics with how we do this. There's a lot of very cool things, but I don't think that time is really going to be on our side if I go into too many details. One detail that I will tell you about, however, is that you must introduce some sort of stochastic bounds into the problem. Okay? You must have some sort of stochastic driving. And the reason is that the stochastic processes are going to choose different vacuum, different ground states, different phases of the world at different points in space. Okay? To put it another way, if you go back to this axiom right here, the equation of motion for the scalar field is just the Klein-Gordon equation. If I start off with the scalar field being zero at the highest, it stays zero forever when you solve classical partial differential equations. So you have to put in some noise to drive the scalar field. And how we're going to do that is that we're going to turn on a non-normalizable mode for the scalar field. We're going to deform the actual Hamiltonian of the field theory. We're going to turn on this non-normalizable mode, and we're going to make it have this sort of statistics, sort of delta function correlated statistics. And this parameter zeta, we're going to choose to be some small number. So here's a cartoon of the bulk physics. Here's your boundary. Here's your horizon. There's going to be some non-normalizable mode turned on here that's going to inject random radiation into the bulk. You should think about this as mimicking the back reaction of G Newton's suppressed Hawking radiation. So in particular, your black hole is going to, if you include it among your interruptions, is going to emit Hawking radiation. That process is itself stochastic. If you want, you can include the back reaction this parameter that I plot zeta here is roughly corresponding to 1 in the
case here. So let me show you some of these. Yes, see your questions for the end of this one. So I'm going to just show you some results from here. The movies are going to show the expectation value of the quantum field theory order parameter squared. This right here would be for a fast quench, a component of a slow quench. The numbers right here, when this passes through time zero, that's when you pass through the critical temperature. The numbers right here, you'll see them grow between 10 to the minus 3 to the minus 4. So initially, you have just nothing really in a stochastic process, and then you see a condensate start to form. And then these little blue dots that you see here are all superfluid compounds, and it seems to be a plus minus one. So there's some number of vertices. You see them start to interact. They can be a little mild if you wait. You can do this for the slow quench too. You see the system freeze in once this passes through. Here, so fluctuation is becoming larger as you approach the critical point. Right here, and now, there you can see it's the form. And you can see just by comparing these two plots right here, the blue form of vertices over here. Okay. So, roughly speaking, you get what you expect. So let me look at the evolution of the condensate right here. So right here I'm showing the average value, the spatially average value of the square of the condensate as a function of time. You pass through Tc at this time. Zero right here. These green symbols here represent the freeze-out time. I've arbitrarily chosen to define that such that the amplitude here is increased by a factor. What you see happen here is you see the condensate grow, and then there's a stark change in the behavior of the growth rate where these red symbols form, and that defines what we're going to call the acceleration time. So, in particular, in this regime right here, the condensate growth is roughly linear. That's exactly what you would expect from adiabatic evolution. The square of the condensate should scale up your reduced temperature to the twice beta. In mean field theory, which is appropriate for holography, the critical exponents use mean field theory exponents. Beta is a half, and so this should be a linear function of time with intercept that goes through the margin. That's exactly what you see right here. The important point that I wanted to bring to your attention here, though, is that there is some initial time of non-adiabatic growth where the condensate is in fact. If you look at this freeze-out time, let's briefly go over this right here, as a function of the quench rate time Q, even though I sort of arbitrarily defined it, you do see that it does scale like root time Q, which is what you would expect using the field exponents for holography. So what I want to do in the next couple slides is study this period of growth here and work out the consequences of it. So everything I'm going to say right here is going to be completely general. It's going to apply far, because it can apply to any theory beyond holography too. Let me consider a condensate correlation function for the sake of example. At sufficiently early times, before a well-defined condensate field, this correlator is given by linear response. Okay? So it's going to, in particular, it's going to be the integral of the square of the retarded size sign correlator with some amplitude given by the amplitude of the noise. Now, what you can do now is you can write down an expression for this retarded Green's function right here simply using the quasi-normal mode, the equilibrium quasi-normal mode dispersion relation of your correlator above Tc. So within the language of the gravitational physics, what you're doing here is you're taking your lowest quasi-normal mode of the black hole, and then you're analytically continuing it
from negative reduced temperatures in the unbroken phase to positive reduced temperatures in the broken phase. Okay. And what happens there is that when epsilon is positive, the imaginary part of this quasimodo becomes positive in the infrared. Okay, so this one here is this sort of expansion here is completely true. A and B are just positive constants here. And what you see what happens here is that only nodes that lie below some cutoff with Q max killing like epsilon. So you can go on ahead now and substitute this expression into this formula right here. You can actually do the integration over t using the saddle point approximation. Let me just write down the answer that you get here. That's at times after the freeze-out, the correlation function is some function of time, which is over here, t to epsilon. Okay. And the width of that epsilon is given by this coarsening scale. The growth of this function you see not here is very easy to understand. There's a factor of zeta, that's just a noise. There's a factor of t freeze. This is a stochastic process. We're looking at the expectation value, the square of something. And so that expectation value is always going to increase in linear time, which is like diffusion. And then there is an exponential growth rate, also followed by this factor of the coarsening scale. Volume of momentum space that's available for the system to access. And this coarsening scale is simply the freeze out scale times this function of time. So the coarsening scale grows as a function of time here. And this linear response analysis is going to break down when this function C naught becomes an order epsilon to the two. That's when the system is going to begin to respond adiabatically. And so what that's going to give you, here is a breakdown of the scale that is the equilibration time, which is related to the freeze-out scale by this logarithm. This log R. The log R is related to the amplitude of the noise of the zeta, and it depends on these exponents here. And D is the dimension of space. So you can compare now my numerics to this unstable mode analysis. You can take this plot here, and instead of plotting as a function of time, plot as a function of t over t freeze to this power, put it on a log scale on the mode axis. And a linear analysis says that this should be a straight line, and the EDC is degree of insulation. So that seems to work pretty well. The other comparison that I will make here is with the tau q. For holography, you use mean field exponents. This scale R, scale is like mean over square root tau q. The freeze out scale is square root tau q. And so ultimately, if you scale out the square root of tau q here and just plot what's left here for the equilibration time, you see some slow fall off when you go up to log tau q. And that's extremely well fit by this. Let me now talk about what's important here, and that is the consequences of extended and not immediate direct bulk growth. We assume that the freeze-out scale is much less than the equilibration time. We'll come back and justify that in a few minutes. If you make this assumption, you don't have any well-defined condensate or vortices that form until the equilibration time. Here's a snapshot. At the freeze out time, and clearly there's no well defined condensate here. Even at 0.85 times the equilibration time, large regions of space where there's no condensate. It's only really at this equilibration time that you get a rather uniform system with not uniform quality speeds that might be topological defects. So, with that being said, then, the coarsening scale evaluated at this equilibration time. Asymptotically large compared to the freeze-out scale. The correlation length is much, much bigger, and correspondingly,
the correlation length increases so dramatically, the state at time T freeze, where Zurek's argument was based, is not really going to imprint itself on the future change. And this just comes back to the fact, going back to a couple slides here, is that the physics that gives you this coarsening scale is due to the fact that your quasi-normal modes become unstable asymptotically deep into the infrared. So all the infrared modes are going to grow up and form the condensate. So now let me come back to the important question. How natural is it to have the equilibration time much greater than the freeze-out time? Well, this happens in all holographic fields. Okay, the reason it is simply because of what you can. The amplitude of your noise is when you're getting suppressed. You have exponential growth. It takes a logarithmic divergent time for that exponential growth to become more into zero. And so your equilibration, there's a way of separation of scales between your equilibration time and your freeze-out scale. And your correlation length and your coarsening scale are very, very different. The other class of theories where this happens is simply the universality classes, where the critical exponents satisfy this sort of scaling here. And when this happens, your equilibration time is asymptotically going up to the freeze-out scale compared with this log top Q factor here. And the example of a theory where that happens is simply a Q. And in particular, because you have a log top Q right here, what's going to happen in your Kibble Zurek scaling is it's that's a typo, that shouldn't be there. The density of defects relative to the Kibble Zurek prediction square root log top Q or to some fraction of power, but nevertheless, it can be different. Okay, so let me finish up very quickly here. Let me just show you a couple more plots. Let me show you numerical evidence of this infrared coarsening before the condensate forms. You can numerically compute the correlation function that I wrote in the previous three slides back. You can watch its evolution as a function of time. Here I've normalized it, so it's and you see that nothing really exciting happens until this point here, which is roughly speaking the freeze-out scale. And then because you have exponential growth of infrared modes, the correlation function rather explodes, and the correlation length becomes very large. You can see that right here. This is the correlation length divided by the freeze-out scale as a function of time. And at the freeze-out scale, the correlation gets roughly 0.1, an increase of 0.5 in this for the parameters that we use. Now, keep in mind, this is just a factor of a logarithm. It's a square root of a logarithm. That's not really that big, but it just turns out that the numerology conspires with you to make this much, much bigger than you might have previously guessed. Okay, so let me finish up very quickly here. You can go ahead and count the density of defects at time t and q. You can compare that now to the Kibble Zurek scaling. This is what you'll get from holography. I've put the factor of log in there. For the parameters that we've used, we get about 25 fewer vortices than the Kibble Zurek estimate. All right, so let me summarize here. For a wide class of theories, in particular any theory with a holographic dual, there exists a new time scale, TEQ. You have an explosive growth of infrared modes between the freeze-out scale and this equilibration time. And in particular, if this equilibration time is very large compared to the freeze-out scale, your initial correlation length that the freeze-out scale is not going to state, you get far fewer defects form. And you also have